Hey there, how are you doing? I hope you're doing good. So welcome back to the channel. I hope you're able to get benefited, from this channel. We are able to add value to your preparation. Here we are today with another new series. Yes, we already have Mains Monday. Now this is another new series called Prelims Mastery. Yes, and this series is also a weekly series. Now, what is this series all about? So what we are going to do and what I'm going to do with you is that every week I'll come to you with 30 questions. Okay, and these 30 questions will be based on the, the contemporary and the current affairs of that particular week. Okay, it may be from PIB, it may be from The Hindu, The Indian Express, and various other sources. So 30 questions from all these sources, we'll be framing and I'll be discussing with you about that. Okay, now this will help you in two ways. For some of you who are not so regular and who find, to keep up to date with the everyday current affairs, this will act as a panacea. Okay, now even if you're not preparing for current affairs every day, once in a week, if you follow this very video series here, Prelims Mastery, you will not only be, learning how to tackle prelims based questions, but also you'll be, getting knowledge about the current and contemporary affairs. Okay, so this is the first advantage. Second advantage, even if you are very regular with your current affairs preparation, this very series will help you in revision. And this will also help you to look at all these contemporary and current affairs from the prelims point of view. All right. So without much further ado, let's begin the Prelims Mastery series. Now in this episode, I'll be covering the current and contemporary affairs of fourth week of the November. Okay, fourth week of the November. And I would be presenting this very episode in a few parts here, because to just reduce the online time, I'll be cutting this into a number of parts, and this will be made available to you in parts. Okay, without further delay, let's begin. But one rule here, okay, not one, two rules here. Two rules are: rule number one, before I go ahead and discuss answers with you after every single question, I want you guys to pause the video after the question and think about the answer. Find out where exactly you stand, and post that, you can play the video so that you can get the answers. Number one. Number two, after end of each part of this video, after end of the episode, I want you guys to leave it in the comment section, as in how much did you score out of 30 questions. Yes, and don't feel bad if you're not able to score high or if you're not able to answer all the questions. Now, this very series, is designed to help you gain knowledge and not to demotivate nor to degrade you in any way. So even if you're not able to answer, relax, no problem. Try to learn from the questions. Okay, so let's begin our very weekly series here, Prelims Mastery, and let's go on to the first question of this very episode. So, all right, so what's the first question here? Which of the following statements are correct? Well, statement one says governor's discretionary powers cannot be reviewed by judiciary at all. The second statement says Article 361 of the Constitution gives immunity to the acts of the governor. Now, the first option is statements one and two, both are correct, or only statement one is correct, only statement two is correct. The option D says neither one nor two are correct here. All right, now pause the video, think about this, and see if you get the right answer. All right, so let's check the answer here. And the answer says option C, only statement 2 is correct. That means Article 361 of the Constitution gives immunity to the acts of the governor. Only this statement is correct, and the statement 1 is wrong. Why it is wrong? Governor's discretionary powers cannot be reviewed by judiciary at all. No, this is wrong. Governor's powers can be reviewed by judiciary. Governor is not, he's not having any kind of blanket here. Okay, so even he comes under the judiciary review. To just quote an example, this was recently seen in the so-called state legislative assembly's floor test in both Karnataka and Maharashtra. Okay, though the governor of Karnataka gave some 15 days of time to the to the leader of the party which got majority of seats. But still, when the other party leaders approached Supreme Court, Supreme Court asked them to reduce the time given for the floor test. So therefore, the governor's decision here was challenged. So henceforth, you have to understand that very less provisions here are outside the ambit of judicial review, but majority of the provisions are inside the very ambit of judicial review. Nobody can escape from the judicial review. All right, so let's go to the next question. What are schist, migmatites and phyllite? What are schist, migmatites and phyllite? What are they? Option A, are they asteroids? Option B, minerals discovered on moon? Option C, rocks? And option D, alloys of iron? Pause the video. All right, so let's check the answer. What is the answer? The answer is, they are C, rocks. And they were in news because these rocks were found during construction of tunnel in Rohtang region. All right, let's go to the next one. Which of the following statements are true about the citizenship amendment bill? Yes, a very hot topic. Okay, so let's understand which are these statements here and which among these statements are correct. Statement one says, relaxation of period of residency for all illegal immigrants to obtain citizenship. There's a statement one. Statement two, it is an amendment to the Citizenship Act of 1995. Option three, empowers central government to cancel the registration of OCI cards in case of violations. So what are the amendments done to the Citizenship Amendment Bill, and what are the correct statements among three? Pause the video, go through the options, and then play the video. All right, now let's check the answer. And the answer is, it says option D, only three. All right, it says the D option, that is, which says the only the third statement is right. And what's the third statement? It says empowers central government to cancel the registration of OCI card in case of violation. And the other two statements are wrong. The first statement says relaxation of period of residency for all illegal immigrants. Now be careful when words like all are used. Okay, it doesn't say that all illegal immigrants are allowed here. It allows only immigrants from three countries, that is Afghanistan, Pakistan and Bangladesh, belonging to only six religions, and not all, only six. And which are those six? Hindus, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis, Christians, Sikhs. So these are the six religions which are allowed from three countries and not all. Hence statement one is wrong. The statement two says it's an amendment to the Citizenship Act of 1995. No, it is an amendment to Citizenship Act of 1955 and not 95. All right. So this is the correct answer here. Okay. So let's go to the next question. All right. Which of the following statements are correct? To conduct floor test, only governor can convene the state legislative session. And the second statement, floor test is conducted by the speaker in the state legislative assembly. Okay, so which of these statements are correct? Is it the first, the second, both, or neither of them are correct? All right, let's check the answer. It says B, two, that is only second statement is correct and first statement is not correct. To conduct the floor test, it is not that only governor can convene the state legislative session, even Supreme Court can convene the state legislative session. As I said, this is again from the Maharashtra and Karnataka state legislative assembly issue. Alright, so please understand, the dynamic topics will be chosen and the static part of it will be taken and given as the question in preliminary examination. So be very careful about this. Okay. Next question. Which of the following statements are correct? The first statement says pro tem speaker conducts floor test in the state legislative assembly and has complete discretion. And the second statement says a governor appoints the pro tem speaker. So which of the following statements are correct? Let's understand the answer. Let's know the answer. It says B2. That means only second point is, second statement is correct, whereas the first one is wrong. It says, pro tem speaker conducts floor test in the legislative assembly and has complete discretion. Pro tem speaker, yes, of course he conducts, you know, floor test, but however, does he have complete discretion? No, he doesn't have complete discretion. Again, Supreme Court can meddle with it. Supreme Court can challenge the even pro tem speaker's very procedure of conducting floor test. You know, some few years back, Supreme Court has asked the pro tem speaker as in how to, conduct the very, the floor test there. Even they directed the speaker as in the procedures to, you know, to conduct floor test. So hence, he doesn't have complete discretion. But however, in the second statement, governor appoints the pro tem speaker, and that's the right statement. Next one. Which of the following statements are correct? Again, IFSC caters to customers outside the jurisdiction of the domestic economy. And the second statement says, India's first IFSC has been set up at Gift City, Gandhinagar. So you should know what exactly is IFSC in the very first place. Okay, so these are the options given. So think about that and see if you can come up with the right answer. So let's check the answer now. Answer says both are correct statements. That means IFSC stands for International Financial Service Center. And International Financial Service Center is a financial center that cater to customers outside their own jurisdiction. That means now with the IFSC center, Indians can give loan to people who are outside India. Maybe a business from Abu Dhabi, a businessman from London, he can get loan from India through IFSC. So IFSC will act as an international loan giver. So please understand. And India's first IFSC, it has been set up at Gift City, Gandhinagar. So you should remember this. Next one. Which of the following are correct statements? Okay, now we have three statements. Statement one says, Article 137 gives power to Supreme Court to review its own verdict. Second statement, only parties involved in the case can file a review. Only parties who are involved in a case, only they can file a review. And the third statement, Supreme Court has discretionary powers to deny or allow a review petition. All right. So of these three, which of the the statements are correct? Now option A says one only, B says one and three, C says one, two and three, and D says only three. So what do you think? Pause and think about that. So let's check the answer here. It says B, 1 and 3. That means Article 137 gives power to Supreme Court to review its own verdict. That is the right statement. And Supreme Court has discretionary powers to deny or allow a review petition. But however, statement 2, that only parties involved in the case can file for a review, is a wrong thing. It's a wrong statement. Why? Not only parties which are involved, but also those people who are affected by the verdict of the Supreme Court can also go and file a petition. So please understand. Okay, so this is with respect to the ongoing Ayodhya, which now it is over, but which was very, it was like a hot topic some weeks back, Ayodhya verdict. So it is about that. Okay. Now, though Muslim Personal Law Board is not part of, the very case here, they are not the party here, but still now they can go and they can file a, file for a review. All right. So this very question is with respect to that issue. So please understand. The next one. Which of the following statements are incorrect? First one, review petition is heard by a different bench of SC other than the one which had given the judgment before. Second one, curative petition is heard once the review petition gets dismissed. So which of the one are incorrect? First one, second one, both, neither. Think about this. Let's check the answer. It says A1. That is, first statement is incorrect. Now, please understand, some of you here, you have to focus on the question. Now, the question says, which of the following are incorrect and not correct? All right. So, these are some of the tricks which UPSC uses. So, please be very, very careful. Okay. Now, the statement one is Incorrect. It says review petition is heard by a different bench of SCE. No, review petition is always heard by the same bench. Until that, unless one or two, you know, judges in that bench, you know, they might get retired or they might resign or they might vacate their place, you know, for one or the other reason. Only in that case, their position is filled by another judge. But unless, you know, something of that happens, the review petition is always heard by the same bench which had given the so-called verdict before, okay, and not to by the different bench. And yes, of course, second one, curative petition is heard only when the review petition gets dismissed. Okay, the next one. Which of the following are correct statements? Number one, golden rice is a genetically modified rice. Number two, the golden color is because of the pigment beta carotene. And number three, it is a source of vitamin B. Which of them are right? So check the options, pause video, think for a minute, and then get back. So let's check the answer. D, 1 and 2. So option 1, I mean the statements 1 and 2 are the correct statements. One says golden rice is a genetically modified rice. That's the right thing. The right statement. The golden color is because of the pigment beta carotene. That's also the right statement. It is a source of vitamin B. This is the wrong statement. It is not a source of vitamin B. It is a source of vitamin A. So please remember. Okay. Now you can also check the explanation here in the solution section, which I can share with you in a PDF format in the Telegram channel. So some of you are not part of the Telegram channel, you can subscribe to the Telegram channel. Now all the answers will be shared with you there. The whole PDF can be shared with you there. Okay, you can download it from there. The next question, 10th one. Now this asks us that which of the following statements are incorrect about FATF, Financial Action Task Force. So which of the following statements are incorrect? The first statement, FATF helps in combating money laundering only. India and other members of BRICS are its members. And the third statement, it's a non-intergovernmental organization. Which of these are correct? Which of the options? A, B, C, D. Which one of the options here is correct? Let's check that. It says A, 1 and 3. So A, 1 and 3 are incorrect. However, statement 2 is correct because the question asks us to find the incorrect statement, okay, not the correct statement. The first one is wrong one and the third one is a wrong one here. So FATF helps in combating money laundering only. No, not only money laundering, it also helps us to identify terrorist financing and other related threats to the integrity of the international financial system. So not only money laundering, but also if any money is getting into terrorist or any other violent activities, it also tracks that. Okay, so this is also one of the very important functions of FATF. Okay, and the second statement says India and other members of BRICS are its members. Yes, all the five nations here are members of FATF. And the third says it's a non-intergovernmental organization. No, it is a intergovernmental organization. That means the India has one of its bureaucrats go and sit there in the FATF secretariat. That means we are represented by a government official and it's not a private body. It's a intergovernmental body here. So please understand. Okay. So with these 10 questions, now end this first part of this episode and I'll continue from 11th question in the next part. Okay. See you there.